you should follow his steps all the time. Now your mind is, what will Christ do? Where will Christ go? How will Christ talk? What will, how will Christ interact? How will Christ fellowship? How will Christ pray? Because now you're following Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. And then he tells us, look at Second Thessalonians chapter 2. I'm reading from verse 13. Second Thessalonians chapter 2. And we're looking at verse 13. The pilgrim, he has a sustained purity. The pilgrim, he has a sustained preservation of that which he has now got. Second Thessalonians chapter 2, I'm reading from verse 13 here. In verse 13 it says, but we are bound to give thanks always to God for you. Why? Brethren, beloved of the Lord. Because God has from the beginning chosen you to salvation. God has from the beginning of our coming to you. And Paul the apostle could see those people. He said, the moment I came to you and I preached the good news to you, you didn't waste time at all. From that beginning of hearing the gospel, he chose you to salvation. And now through sanctification, through sanctification, you see that after you are born again, you'll not just say, praise the Lord, I am saved. Praise the Lord, my sins are forgiven. Now I can commit more sins and go back to church next Sunday and say, God, we have done what we shouldn't have done. We have not done what we should have done. Forgive me again. No, sir. You are saved. He saves you from sin. You're saved. He saves you from sinning. You are saved. He saved you from repeating the old life again. And then that's an external experience. All the stealing, that's external. All the lying, that's external. All the adultery, that's external. All the fornication, that's external. All the drunkenness, that's external. All those external branches of the tree of sin has now been cut down. And the place looks free. You look at that area now. Where is that tree? All the branches are gone. All those things we see here, cluttering the ground. Everything is gone, but it's the root there. The root is still there. And now that's why sanctification comes in. Now, the digger of the Lord, the bulldozer of the Lord, will uproot that thing. And when that thing is uprooted, that's the second experience. It's called sanctification. And here it says, the Lord has chosen you to salvation. And then it talks about, through sanctification of the Spirit and belief of the truth. Now the Spirit comes in, the place now is empty. And the place is pure. Number one is peace. You have peace with God through Jesus Christ. You're saved. Number two is purity. You're sanctified. He purifies your heart. Number three is power. The power of the Holy Ghost. If you have not received that power has now come. I said that power has now come. But you shall receive power. After that, the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses of it, both in Jerusalem and Judea, and then to the uttermost part of the earth. And look at 2 Timothy here. 2 Timothy, I'm reading from chapter 2. 2 Timothy chapter 2, and we're looking at verse 21. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 21. If a man therefore purge himself from these, if a man therefore purge himself from these. You know, mothers that try to clean up their children, good job. But you see, when you transfer that to the spiritual, and you have not taken your bath, and you're trying to clean up other people, you concentrate on other people, you labor on other people, clean them up, purify them, purge them. And meanwhile, your life is not what it ought to be. And the Lord is saying, if a man will forget all the other people he wants to cleanse, he wants to purge, he wants to purify, and if a man will purge himself from all these things that will hinder him and that will not allow him to be a clean, pure, new, renewed pilgrim. If a man therefore purge himself from these, he shall be a vessel unto honor, sanctified. That's the word again. There's sanctification, there's salvation, there's peace of God, there's forgiveness, there's eternal life, there's a ticket to heaven, there's a fitness for heaven. Salvation is a ticket for heaven. But sanctification is a fitness for heaven, that he fits you, he equips you, and prepares you, and says, now you are ready. Shall the trumpet sound? You're ready. If a man therefore purge himself from this, it shall be a vessel unto honor. He is purified and sanctified and meet for the master's use and prepared unto every good work. Then he says in verse 22, flee also youthful lusts. You see, when you are saved, you will not want to be staying around temptation, around lust, around evil sin, and then a kind of dragging your feet. There's somebody there in the corner, an object of temptation, but there's something in your heart that rebels against that. That's not right. Why is she like that? Why is she exposing that? Why is she exhibiting that? Why is that man exhibiting that? They're exhibiting that to attract your attention. Say, no, my heart is no more there. And then you turn away. Turn away my heart from beholding vanity. You're saved. But now, in your heart, there must still be that magnet. You remember that thing. And then it's becoming a problem to you. You go back to Calvary. You say, Lord, I don't even want to have this magnet inside me. That although I've turned my mind, turned my eyes away from beholding vanity, I want the magnet from within to even be totally eradicated so that that should not be a problem to me anymore. That's why I say, now you flee youthful lusts and you follow righteousness, you follow faith, you follow charity, and you follow peace with them that call on the Lord out of a pure heart, out of a sanctified heart. It will happen. I said it will happen. And when it happens, what joy you will have, what freedom you will have. You'll be able to say, praise the Lord, I am saved. You'll be able to say, praise the Lord, I am sanctified. There is a freedom within. And I said, the totality of this freedom within, that wherever you are, you'll be able to say, shall the Lord come any moment? There's nothing that says, Lord, don't come now. Don't come now. I have this to settle. Everything is settled. The old account is settled. Long ago, settled in your heart, settled in your spirit, and settled in your life. Peace and purity. It tells us here, in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. Pilgrims need to understand this. Otherwise, you know, if you say you're a pilgrim and you're traveling, and you have the weight of guilt on your mind, the weight of condemnation on your mind, and the weight of the shackles of sin, besetting sin in your life, you cannot run well and you cannot move well. But it is when you're saved, you're sanctified, there's peace, there's purity, and you're a pilgrim, you'll be able to move. You'll move freely. Look at this in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 22. Abstain from all appearance of evil. You know, nobody has to interpret that to you. As a child of God, if you're a real pilgrim, you know that all this sin, evil, will hinder your movement to heaven. The only thing you have in your mind, because you are breathing with Christ, therefore you desire those things above. And because you desire those things above, anything that is evil, anything that will tie you down, anything that will hinder you from getting to that glorious place, you say, no, it will not be. Even the appearance of evil, you're not really sure it is evil. You're not really sure it is bad. You're not really sure it's going to be so, but it smells like poison. It smells like, acid. It smells like something that is not acceptable. Just the odor, just the smell, just the appearance, abstain from all appearance of evil, and the very God of peace sanctify you how? Holy, entirely, completely. And I pray, God, your whole spirit and soul and body be preserved blameless unto the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Faithful is he that calleth you. Tell me the rest. Also will do it. He will do it. I said he will do it. When he does it, he sets you free, completely free. Number one is the peace. Number two is the purity. Number three is the power. Power is coming. I said, power is coming. You know, sometimes, I don't know what you expect during the covenant service. Some people say, let, you know, somebody pray for me and I have this. And why pick up just 1% of the blessing when you can have 100% and God gives you the power, he gives you the spirit, he gives you everything so that anywhere you go, you yourself, you'll be a terror to the devil. You'll be a terror to demons. Anywhere you go, you'll not be looking for, you know, somebody there pray for me, somebody there pray for me. Even standing alone, the fire of the Holy Ghost is burning inside you. I'm talking to somebody there today. The fire of the Holy Ghost is burning all around you. And as the fire is burning, all those, whatever they call them, evil spirits, demons, whatever, they are running up before you even say anything. And when you stand up to mention the name of Jesus, it will be like you are the only one that knows the name of Jesus. They call the name of Jesus, but they are not saved because they are dead. What comes out of them is dead. And because they are feeling guilty, there's a weight that is pulling them down. And when they say Jesus, it doesn't go beyond the ceiling. But you're saved. You're sanctified. You're baptized in the Holy Ghost. And the power of God is there. You mention Jesus. Oh, you say, Jesus I know. Paul I know. And you I know. Let me go. I'm leaving. They will leave. Sickness will leave. Evil spirit will leave. All those powers of darkness, they will leave in Jesus' name. You know, when you have this power I'm talking about, I'm going to read it. You'll see it yourself. When you have this power I'm talking about, if they meet you in the day, you will knock them down. If they meet you in the night, they're waiting until you sleep. You say, I'm asleep, but my heart is awake. You know, when you sleep, if you are baptized in the Holy Ghost in you does not sleep. And the angels watching over you, they do not sleep. And even though you're sleeping, and they come and they try to sneak in, and they want to put any hand on you, they will strike fire. And something there will burn. Look at it yourself. I'm looking at Matthew chapter 3. Matthew chapter 3, and I'm reading from verse 11 and verse 12. Matthew chapter 3, we're looking at verse 11. It says in verse 11, I did baptize you with water unto repentance, but he that cometh after me is mightier than I, whose shoes I am not worthy to bear. He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost. Tell me the rest. And with fire, Holy Ghost and fire, Holy Ghost and fire, Holy Ghost and fire. And when that fire comes, it'll burn every chaff out of your life, burn every sickness out of your life, and burn every infirmity out of your life. And all those things, I'm not sure about this, I'm not sure about that. Holy Ghost fire comes, it'll burn everything away in Jesus' name. You know, I know some people, they say, Pastor, I'm saved. I say, tell me the story. I'm sanctified. I said, keep on talking. He says, I'm baptized in the Holy Ghost. And then I said, what have you come for now? They say, Pastor, I want you to pray for me. I said, but you're baptized in the Holy Ghost now. He says, yes, but something is walking over my body. And something is seizing my brain. And something is taking my intestine. And something is, you know, making my blood to be polluted. And I didn't go anywhere. But something is telling me that I have HIV. I said, but where is the fire? The fire will burn today. And all those things, you know, many people, they don't understand. And this kind of Christian life, I say, but how are you a pilgrim? And what power do you have? Fire has come. Power, fire. Fire, power. And when it comes over there, look at verse 12. It says, whose fan is in his hand, and he will thoroughly purge his floor and gather his wheat into the garner, and he will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire. Fire will be burning continually inside your soul. You know, somebody says, I'm baptized in the Holy Ghost, and you know, we say we're going to pray now, and I was saying, Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. And as you look at the man baptized in the Holy Ghost, he's already snoring. He cannot pray for 10 minutes and is baptized in the Holy Ghost. A man baptized in the Holy Ghost, he cannot have quiet time. If he kneels down like this, thank you, Jesus, I'm saved. Thank you, Jesus, I'm sanctified. Thank you, Jesus, I'm baptized in the Holy Ghost. And then he's trying to read, 10 verses of scripture for personal quiet time. He's reading one line, two times, baptized in the Holy Ghost. And then after that, he tries to pray. And, the wife will come and wake him up and say, sir, look at the time. We're for work. I was having quiet time. And are you saying, yes, sir, I'm saved. Sanctified, yes, sir, I'm sanctified. Baptized, sir, 19 such and such, I was baptized in the Holy Ghost. Why don't you repack your load today? Why don't you check up again today? Because that thing will not carry you anywhere. I'm telling you that there's something coming your way today that will carry you up. That will move you on. And all those things that have come inside your heart, fire will come today. You know, today we're going to pray. If you're going to pray, where are you? I said we're going to pray. When I finish the preaching, as you know, we've done this now from, last retreat and at the Congress, somebody else will come and lead us, and then you will pray yourself, and then after some time, don't go home, because today, power, generator power is coming inside you. The bulldozer power is coming inside you. So don't go away today. After we finish preaching, then you pray for yourself. And then, by the grace of God, I don't always say this, but I'll tell you, I'm loaded for you today. And then, we're going to pray and something will happen to you. This pilgrimage, you will walk free. Nothing will touch your life. And then Satan will see you. He'll think he's the old man. And then Satan will dodge from you from today. Because when power comes, authority comes in your life. Anointing that breaks every yoke comes upon your life. You're saved, peace with God. You're sanctified, purity of heart. And then you're baptized in the Holy Ghost, the power of the Holy Ghost. Look at Acts of the Apostles chapter 1. Acts of the Apostles chapter 1, I'm reading here from verse 4. In verse 4 it says, and being assembled together with them, he commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait. You see that? But wait. There are many people who are in a hurry. I don't know why they're in a hurry. Remember the Lord on the Lord's day. You remember his name. You remember his worship. The whole day belongs to the Lord. And then you find some people on Sunday, the Lord's day, they're in a hurry. Why are you in a hurry? It says, but wait for the promise of the Father, which says ye have heard. Then it says, for John truly baptized with water, but tell me now, but he shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. Look at verse 8, it says in verse 8, but he shall receive power. After that, the Holy Ghost is come, he will come. After that, the Holy Ghost is come, he will come upon you. And ye shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem, and in all Judea, and in all Samaria, and unto the uttermost part of the earth. It will happen. We're looking at 1 John chapter 3. 1 John chapter 3, and I'm reading from verse 1. Beloved, behold, what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God. Therefore, the world knoweth us not, because it knew him not. Beloved, now are we the sons of God, and it does not yet appear what we shall be. But we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him.